thank you, Lord, to be able to come into this house tonight to worship your holy name. Father, we thank you for you this evening. We pray, God, that you just come down and touch every heart, touch every soul. May we touch you, Lord God, with all our hearts. In Christ's name, amen. One, two, three.
This is unfailing love that he would
free. Amen. We're free. Hey. Tries to roll over our bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy that you own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. When my heart gets heavy, you all been there. When our bones get weak, when we cannot stand up, His love will carry me. Yeah, He will. Huh. And when when these fears we're fighting feels like sure defeat. Oh, I will run and hide in the love you offer me. Oh, the goodness of the Lord never fails me. The goodness of the Lord overwhelms me. The goodness of the Lord is always true.
It's always true.
His word never lies. When my soul is weary, Lord, oh, and my spirit gets dry, oh, you know, God, I so often wander away. Still, you never leave my side. Oh, Father, my heart, I praise you. Oh, that my life I would sing, yes, Lord, for only you deserve, God, this worship. Footprints in the sand, God. You're always there. Even with the times we don't think you're there. Whoa, it's not true. We got it backwards, God. You're there. Thank you, Lord, for getting us through each and every day. For eternity, God, we're going to praise you. Thank you for who you are. We love you, Father. Y'all know this one. That's why he is jealous for me. He loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. By his glory, and then I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affection are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. Just want to hear people sing it. Oh, come on, sing it.
How he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us so.
Thank you, Father. We can get pretty unlovable, but you still love us. Thank you, God. We'll forever praise you, Lord, in the Lamb of God. Oh, God, you're so good. How we love you, Lord, for loving us before ever knew you, Lord. Blows our mind. But we just praise you and thank you, God, for all that you are and all that you're doing. We pray, God, you continue, Lord, to anoint this service, anoint Sister Tammy, anoint this place. God, continue, Holy Ghost, to have your way in here this evening. We love you, Father. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. And the church said, amen. Praise God.
Amen. Oh, how he loves us. Let's love on each other. If you want to greet your neighbor. All the introverts, just wave from where you're sitting. It's okay. Good evening, everyone. You can go ahead and bring that. So Pastor Darren, Pastor Jay, and Pastor Joey are all at a conference together. Yeah, trouble. No, they are enjoying themselves, getting fed, and let's just continue to pray for them as they are up north, and that they'll come back refreshed and just have vision and all be on the same page. I think that's just amazing that they got this time together. So they'll be back for Sunday. And but this Sunday, we are having a guest speaker, Dwayne and Jeannie Vanderklok. And they're actually where Dwayne is right now. So That's where they're gleaning from. So you don't want to miss it. If you've never heard Pastor Dwayne, you just don't want to miss it. I've heard him in person, but I also listen to him on his podcast pretty often too. And he has a lot of wisdom and is anointed. Also, tomorrow evening is what? Silver Stars. That's right. Good job, y'all. And Silver Stars is for anybody 50 years old and up. So I'm not even 50 and I have silver. So it's okay if you claim to be at the Silver Stars. So it's at 6 p.m. tomorrow evening. You don't want to miss that. Some of you all will see you there. Christmas play. If you haven't heard, we're going to do a kids Christmas play this December, and we need your kids to be able to pull this off. So if you are interested in having your child do this, or your child hopefully will be agreeable to that, you need to go ahead and register them. You can do that by signing them up on the Church Center app. If you go to the signups button on the Church Center app, practices will be on Wednesdays during service, so there's no extra evening. If you're already here on Wednesdays, it's going to work for you. So, yeah, see, there's the Church Center app. If you don't have that, you should get it. And another reminder, pre-service prayer is every Wednesday in room 6, downstairs in the basement at 6 p.m. It's a great time to come and just be with our brothers and sisters in Christ and pray. So talk to Jesus and listen to him. Sound good? Y'all ready for a word? All right, let's welcome Miss Tammy.
Good evening, church. I brought my phone up with me. Not that I can see it. I don't have my glasses on. If my iPad dies here in a little bit, I may have to borrow somebody's readers. That's just how I roll. My iPad's almost gone. So this evening, we're just going to get right into it. I have a hard word for you. I know, surprise, right? I have become known for the one who delivers the tough ones. And people have told me that my superpower is being able to deliver a hard word in such a sweet way that most normal people don't get offended. So I'll take it. If that's true, I don't know if that's true or not, but the Lord gives me these kind because this is how he speaks to me. He speaks to me in a very direct but very loving way, and so that's how I'm going to speak to you because that's how he gives it to me. He needs to be direct with me because that's how I understand. You know, if a word doesn't change me, I'm wasting my time. If a word from God doesn't make me more like Jesus, what am I even doing? So I just want the Lord to just be direct with me and say, this is what you need to work on. And I want to let you know that I don't bring these hard words because I enjoy it, because I don't. I beg the Lord to let me preach on something else, and he brought me back to this time after time after time. And but I also want to let you know that it's not because I have it all together. It's not because I have arrived. It's not because I know it all and I'm just giving you, no, it's the complete opposite. I am most of the time a total train wreck, and so when the Lord deals with me about something, I am walking through it with you. And so if I'm walking through something and he's dealing with me, then I'm going to assume that since he told me to bring this word to you, that maybe some of you are dealing with this too, and maybe it'll help you. And you know, there are things that we try to avoid in the church because they're sticky little topics that we don't want to really talk about or address, but it's keeping us from God's best. And I don't want anything keeping me from God's best. I want the best that he has to offer me. How about you? And sometimes that means a hard word. It's not because I have all the answers, because nothing could be farther from the truth. Speaking of having all the answers, I want to tell you a cute story because a little sugar with the medicine, right? And also because I'm a grandmother, so I always have to have a story about one of my grandchildren because that's my heart. And also because Pastor Darren tried to tell this story a little while back and completely butchered it. So I'm going to redeem this story because it's so cute and it's so funny. All right, so one of our granddaughters, I think it might have been Gwenny, but I'm not 100% sure, was talking with her Poppy in the other room, and I heard them talking with each other, and I was in the kitchen, you know, minding my own business, doing my own thing, wasn't paying any attention to what they were talking about, and she comes running into the kitchen, and she says, "Nani, Poppy says he has all the answers. Is that true?" And I said to her, "Yes, sweetheart, it is absolutely true. Poppy does have all the answers. And some of them are even right." That was the story. Now, see, wasn't that much better? So, again, I'm not here because I have all the answers. I'm here because I'm walking this walk with you, and we are doing this together. And the Lord's teaching us, and he's growing us, and that's what we want to do as disciples of Jesus, right? If we're not learning, and we're not growing, and if we're not moving toward Jesus, then we're falling behind. So, tonight, I kept it closed because my battery's dying. That's it. I'm also real. Okay, so again, I'm going to address a very difficult subject tonight. We're going to deal with a sin that no one wants to talk about in church, but the Bible calls it an abomination. Now, I know what you're thinking, but you're wrong. Why is it that when we mention the word abomination, homosexuality always comes into the picture? That's what we think of first, okay? That's what we want to call an abomination. There are several other abominations to God in the word, okay? So we're going to address one of the other ones. It's easy to use homosexuality as a scapegoat because most of us in the church don't struggle with same-sex attraction. And it's very easy to point the finger at a sin that we don't personally struggle with. So, tonight, I am going to address another abomination that is much more widely accepted and rampant throughout the church. And that is pride. I'm afraid I came to meddle tonight. Pride is a problem that we all wrestle with. And if your first thought was, "Well, I don't," this is especially for you. Proverbs 6, 16 and 17 says, "These six things the Lord hates." Yes, seven are an abomination to him. And number one on the list is pride. Seven things God hates. And number one is pride. So why are we okay with it? Why are we okay with that dwelling in our hearts and keeping us from God's best life? Proverbs 6, 5 says, "Everyone proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord." Jesus, help us. Did you hear what the word says? One of the dangers of pride is that it keeps us from examining our own lives. You know, the plank in the eye and all that. And it amazes me how we can have a giant plank in our own eye and it does not hinder us in the least from seeing the speck in someone else's eye. It's amazing to me. Pride keeps us from examining our own lives and opening up our hearts to the Lord and saying, "God, whatever is in me that displeases you, deal with me about it." Pride keeps us from doing that. It's very gratifying to the flesh to feel superior to others. It's also sin. What is the sin of pride? Well, it's not a sense of accomplishment in a job well done. That's something completely different. That is not the sin of pride. We call that pride, but that's something that we all can feel, whether we cut our grass, vacuum our house, or get our master's degree, whatever the case may be. I'm not talking about that. The sin of pride, first of all, is an attitude of independence from God. Almost any sin can be traced back to pride. Let me say that again. Hang on. I want to correct myself. Any and all sin can be traced back to pride because, by very definition, pride is doing the opposite of what God says to do. Therefore, it's essentially saying, "I know what your word says, God, but no thanks. I'm good. I can do it on my own. I know best. That's pride. Secondly, it's an attitude of ungratefulness to God. Do we get ungrateful? I do. Ungratefulness leads to complaining, and complaining leads to bitterness. The Lord just kind of helped me past myself with this because I've been complaining a lot lately. Jesus needs to help me. I've been complaining a lot about the economy. Anybody else? Am I the only one? Is it just me, or does every single thing in the world cost $400? Like, every time I go to the grocery store, $400. You can't walk into Sam's without spending $400. Take the dog to the vet, $400. Get a medical bill, $400. Everything is $400. I don't know about you, but I do not have infinity $400. Do you? And so I've been complaining about that. And the Lord just kind of this week started lovingly but directly dealing with my heart about that. And complaining about that is just saying, I don't trust you, God. I'm going to lean on my own understanding. And I'm just going to handle this. I'm going to figure this out. You know, I can't afford all this stuff, God, but I don't need your help with this. I got this. Complaining. Ungratefulness. Pride. Jesus, help me. Thirdly, it's thinking yourself better than others. Or even thinking of yourself before others. You know, a lot of us don't think that we're better than anybody else, but we do think of ourselves before someone else. Pride needs to be first. Pride needs to be right. Pride has an unteachable spirit. Often we're not trying to solve the problem. We are trying to win the argument. And that's pride. It's possible to be right and still be the problem because of our attitude. I've said it a million times, and I'm going to say it at least one more, probably more than that. But I believe that God is more interested in why we do things than what we actually do. God is interested in the heart, the motivation behind the things that we do. Why are we doing what we do? Because you can do a very good thing and have a very bad motive. You can do a very bad thing and have a good motive if you're immature and, you know, haven't prayed about those things. But it's possible to do something wrong. How many times have you hurt someone's feelings inadvertently trying to help them? See what I'm saying? What do you call that, Elmer? Good? I love that so much. Dumb stuff out of good people's mouth. And we've all been there. We've all been on both ends of that conversation, I assure you. Offense is pride. Offense is saying, how dare you treat me this way. That's pride. Impatience. Oh, Jesus, help me. I got aggravated with two drivers on two separate occasions on the way here tonight. And I'm by and large, I am not an impatient person, but I'm just like looking at God saying, I hear you. Impatience is pride. It says, I deserve. Judgment. Remember that plank? Judgment is pride. Judgment says, I'm better. Isolation, this is a hard one. Isolation is pride. Because isolation says, I don't need anyone. The gospel, this is good. If you have something to write, you need to write this down. The gospel must be devoid of any pride. For the moment our pride steps in, it ceases to become the gospel. I'm going to say that again for those of you who missed it. The gospel must be devoid of any pride, because the moment my pride steps in, it ceases to become the gospel. Any gospel that causes you to argue and quarrel with others is no gospel. It's pride. The gospel doesn't need you to defend it. The gospel of Jesus Christ can stand on its own. Pride has to be right. Any gospel that enjoys making others look stupid or unspiritual is no gospel. It's pride. Any gospel that separates you from other believers is no gospel. It's pride and isolation. Any gospel that is exclusive is no gospel. It's pride. Pride defies. Why does God hate pride so much? Because pride is what created the devil. Pride is what turned the angel Lucifer into Satan. Among Paul's standards for a preacher was that he must not be a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. 1 Timothy 3:6. Pride ruined humanity. In the Garden of Eden, do you think the temptation was really a new and different fruit that they had never had before? The temptation was to be like God. The temptation was pride. Pride also divides. There has never been an argument, war, divorce, or church split in which pride was not the major factor. Pride divides. Proverbs 13:10 says, "By pride comes nothing but strife." Proverbs 28:25 says, "He who is of a proud heart stirs up strife." God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. 1 Peter 5:5. If God resists the proud, then the proud man is out of fellowship with God. Anyone who is out of fellowship with God is also out of fellowship with other believers. That's isolation. And isolation leads to self-pity. Self-pity leads to depression. If we isolate ourselves and stay away from church, stay away from our family, stay away from the people who love us, encourage us, lift us up, if we separate ourselves from that, we can fall into self-pity. They don't care about me. They don't want to be around me. Nobody called me. They don't want me there anyway. Nobody even notices. Do you know that that's pride? You are not that important. That's pride in ourselves. We think ourselves more important than we actually are. We isolate ourselves. I don't need them anyway. And it puts us into a depression. How many of us are walking around depressed? That is not God's best for you. Pride is keeping us from God's best. And you hear people say, "Well, I don't have to go to church to serve God." My husband and I love Mexican food. We love it. We eat it at least once a week, sometimes twice a week. And sometimes we get tired and we don't want to go out, whatever, we don't want to get ready. So we order in the Mexican food. And we say the same thing every time we do this. It is never as good as it is when you just go into the restaurant. The chips are stale. The sauce is gross. The cheese is congealed and lumpy. And the food, it just doesn't taste the same. And it's the same way with church. I'm thankful that I can order in Mexican food if I'm not able to get out to go to the restaurant. I'm thankful I can watch church on the internet if I'm not able to get out and go to church. I'm thankful that that's a tool. It's better than not having Mexican food at all, right? But here's what we do. We stay out of church. We stay away from God's people. And we say, "I don't need that. I don't need those people. I don't need to hear what they have to say. I don't need to be around people." And it's isolation. And pride is at the root of it. Pride dishonors. What does the proud person want? Praise, honor, esteem. What does he get through pride? Proverbs 11:2 says, "When pride comes, then comes shame." The fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom, and before honor is humility. Proverbs 15:33. I have a lot of scriptures tonight, and that just goes to show how many times God puts the word pride in the Bible. Do you think that means something? I think it probably means that we need to allow him to work on our hearts. A man's pride will bring him low, but the humble in spirit will retain honor. Proverbs 29:23. The Bible also says, don't think more highly of yourself than you ought. If you take the applause, you'll also take the criticism. That's one of the dangers of pride. You know, we're all about listening to someone give us a pat on the back or tell us what a great job we've done or tell us how wonderful we are. But if we listen to that and if we take that to our heart and if that's where we find our identity, then we'll also hear the criticism, and they both come. You're going to get criticized just as much as you're going to get complimented. If you listen to one, you'll listen to the other. And that's the danger of pride. It's not thinking too highly of ourselves. It is thinking too highly of ourselves when we shouldn't be considering that at all. The proud man wants to be praised, complimented, given credit, honored. And the very thing that he wants causes him to lose the admiration of others. He ends up not with admiration, but with contempt. Pride destroys. Lastly, Proverbs 16:18, pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before the fall. Pride will make you absolutely miserable. All of these things that I've talked about, the isolation, the complaining, the ungratefulness, when we get stuck in these things, it causes us to become miserable. And misery loves company. You know, I used to think that that meant that if I'm miserable, I want people around me because it helps cheer me up. That's not what that means. When someone's miserable, they want everybody else to be miserable too. They don't want to be alone in their misery. That's what that means. And so when we're miserable, we drag other people down with us. So not only are we not living God's best life, not only am I not living God's best life for me, but I'm causing others to not live the life God has for them by pulling them into my misery. Pride destroys financially. Some folks are in complete financial ruin because others are buying things that I can't afford and I have to keep up. C.S. Lewis wrote, "Pride gets no pleasure out of having something, only out of having more of it than the next man." Isn't that good? Pride destroys relationships. It keeps us from apologizing, and it keeps us from forgiving. Pride destroys relationships. Pride will destroy us emotionally. Again, isolation, complaining, self-pity, depression, all of these things. It'll destroy us emotionally. It'll also destroy us spiritually. And this is the most dangerous one. I love this passage of Scripture. I think it's funny. It would be funny if it wasn't. Luke 18, 11 through 14. I'm getting a bunch of texts right now on my phone. Excuse me. Let me silence that. I've still got plenty of battery life left. Luke 18, 11 through 14, the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. "God, I thank you that I am not like other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector over here. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess." And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Humble yourself, or God will do it for you. It's so much easier to do it ourselves. It's so much easier to see that plank in our own eye and try to let God remove it through his sweet surgery. It's so much easier than to not see it and fall. Humility is hard. If it was easy, everyone would do it. Humility is hard, but it's the only way up. Are you down? Get up. If you get knocked down, the only answer is to get back up. The righteous may get knocked down 7 times, but he gets back up. It doesn't matter how many times you get knocked down. What matters is that you get up one more time. Keep getting up. Are you down? Get up. The way up is humility. Humble yourself. It's not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. Humble yourself. Down is the way up. It's simple, but it isn't easy. All right, we have a man watching online right now who is in such a place spiritually that he's about to take his own life. We're going to pray for him right now. Join me in prayer, church. I want to speak to you right now, and I want to tell you that Jesus loves you. You are worth more than you think you are. God loves you more than you think he does. Jesus, right now, I pray, God, that you would go into the room where this man is. And Holy Spirit, I pray, God, that you would envelop him, that he would physically, tangibly feel your presence. Pray, church, lift him up to Jesus. That the darkness would go in the name of Jesus. I speak to the darkness in that room. I speak to the darkness that is trying to consume this man, and I command you to go right now in the name of Jesus. Go right now. You have no power. You have no dominion. I plead the blood of Jesus over his mind right now, that he has the mind of Christ. Father, I pray that you would transform and renew his mind right now, that depression would go in the name of Jesus, that the voices would go in the name of Jesus, that the darkness would go in the name of Jesus, that God, he would feel your love wrap around him right now, God, that you would just be with him right now, Father. Lord, speak to him. God, I pray that you would dispel the lies and that you would speak truth to him right now. Jesus, I pray that you would speak truth. You are truth. Your love is strong. Your love is greater than anything. Your love is greater than anything that we face, any battle that comes against us. And there is nothing, nothing worth losing what you've given us. Tomorrow will be a better day. It always gets better tomorrow. Always. God is faithful. God, you are faithful. Always. And it doesn't matter how dark the night is, joy always comes in the morning. Joy always comes in the morning. So I speak joy to you right now. I speak joy to you right now. I speak peace to your mind in the name of Jesus. Yes. God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Father. We're believing by faith, God, that you are intervening right now. That, God, you're doing something in this man. Lord, I thank you right now, God, that he's opening up his heart to you and that he would receive you as his Lord and his Savior, that he would pray, God, here I am. I need you in my life. I need you now more than ever. Lord, I pray, God, that you would just come to him, Lord, that he would open up his heart to you, that you would save his soul, redeem his life, and change his thought process. Father, we thank you for it. We believe it. We believe that it's done. We believe that it's done in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, we lift you up. You're worthy, Lord. You are worthy. You're altogether lovely. Continue to pray, church. I'm just going to finish this, and we're going to get to the altar call. I just want to tell you right now, and I want to tell you right now, focus. Get your focus off of yourself and onto others. Thank you, Jesus. They're on the phone with him right now. Keep praying, church. Keep praying, church. Thank you, Jesus. God, we thank you. You're so faithful. You're so good. You're so faithful. You're so good. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Praise him, church. Praise him, church. Yes. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Shh. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Lord. It's all about your focus. Get your focus off your problems and onto his blessings. Get your focus off of what you don't have and what he's given you. Get your focus off of everything else and get it onto Jesus. If you focus on Jesus, all of these things will pale in comparison to his glory. Cast your attention upon him. He's the one who can help. He's the one who can save. He's the one who can change your life. Jen, can you come up and play something? We're going to close tonight. This is not at all how I thought we were going to close, but God has his plans. And there was someone who needed help. He needed prayer. And God knew to put him in touch with people here who would pray him through. So right now tonight, if you want to come, stand up to your feet tonight. If you want to come and pray for this gentleman, come and pray. Pray in the Spirit if you have that gift. If you struggle with pride, come and ask the Lord. He'll take it. He'll teach you. He'll show you. He'll gently walk with you. Whatever it is tonight, if you just want to pray, if you struggle in your own mind with depression, with self-pity, with thoughts of worthlessness, if you struggle with who you are, your identity in Christ, you may be in the building, you may be watching online tonight, but whoever you are, bring it to Jesus. He's the only one who can help us. Lay down your pride. Pride is what keeps us from Jesus. Lay down your pride. The truth is that no one is too far gone that they can't be saved. And on the other hand, no one is so righteous that they don't need saved. We all need Jesus. We all need Jesus. So let's pray, whether it's at your seat or whether it's at this altar. That's what this altar is for. But you can pray in your seat as well. So tonight, let's lift up our requests to God. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for this time that we've had together tonight. We thank you, God, for putting us in touch with someone who needs you. And Lord, I pray, God, that the ones who are talking with him right now, God, Lord, I believe there's one talking with him who has been there in the same place. Lord, I thank you for those connections. I thank you that you're so good that way. You love this gentleman so much that you've put him in connection with someone who's been there. God, you're good. Oh, you're good. Lord, help us to lay down our pride tonight and just to come to you. Help us to come to you with humble hearts, saying, Lord, I just need you. And Lord, I'm coming to you right now saying, Lord, I need you. I can't take another step. I can't take another breath unless you help me do it. God, you're faithful. Whatever those things are that are in our heart that shouldn't be, Lord, sweetly, gently, lead us. Teach us. Teach us how to do better. Teach us how to live better. Teach us, God, how to have the life that you intend for us to have. Your word says that you have life for us, and it's abundant. It's an abundant life. But, Lord, we're not living in it. We're not walking in it because we're in our own way. Lord, get me out of my way because I want what you have for me, Lord. Lead us, guide us, direct us in all truth. The truth is what's going to set us free. Lord, I thank you for your truth. I thank you that you speak truth in love always because you're a good father. So tonight, as we come to you, we lift up our hearts to you. We ask you to do a work. Lord, do a work in my heart tonight. Do a work in the hearts all around this sanctuary, all around this altar, all around the rooms of the people who are watching online, God, whether they're in the hospital, whether they're at home, whether they're in a hotel room, whatever the case may be, Lord, I pray, God, that you would do a work in hearts. Help us to open up our hearts to you, God, each one of us. Lord, we may not be in such a pit of despair as we've heard about tonight, but Lord, we have our own pit that we like to get in, Father, and I just pray, God, that you would pull us up out of that pit. Whatever pit we get in, pull us up, God, because we know that humbling ourselves down is the way up. So pull us up, God, with humility. Pull us up out of our pit of despair. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We praise you. We worship you. We adore you, God. There's none like you all around this house tonight. Let's just praise him, church. Let's just praise him tonight, church. He's worthy. God, you're worthy. We lift up praises to you, Lord. God, we lift up a praise offering to you. Oh, hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah to you, God. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Jesus. Speak that name over your situation right now. Jesus. All around the sanctuary, speak the name Jesus. Over your mind, Jesus. Over your heart, Jesus. Over your spirit, Jesus. Over the sickness that's trying to overtake you, Jesus. Over your financial situation, Jesus. Over your relationship, Jesus. Lord, we need you. Help us, Father. Lord, as we go from this place tonight, I pray, God, that you would go with us, that we would take you with us, Lord. Your desire, I know, is to go with us, to indwell your people. So, Lord, I pray that each one of us would make the decision to take you with us out of here tonight. That, God, this word would not stop as we exit the door, but that it would continue, that you would continue to speak to our hearts, that you would continue to grow the seed that's been planted in hearts tonight, and that you would get all the glory. We love you tonight, and we ask it in Jesus' name. You're dismissed tonight, but you're still welcome to pray as long as you would like. And I pray that God will protect you and keep you safe, and that his face would shine upon you as you go tonight. Be blessed.